Thank you for coming. So today we'll be doing the 17th chapter. How is everybody doing? So, all right. So we'll start with our Mangalacharan prayers. Victoria, you're familiar with the Mangalacharan prayers? We'll be putting up right in the front just in case. But in case you want to also see this on page 1 of the introduction. Right here. Balaram Hare Krishna.
Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guruha Shri Yutapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tvam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Vyascha Kripa Sindhu Vyayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Matsamo nasti papatma, na paradhi chakaschana, parihare pilajjame, kimbhruve purushottama, bhumau skalita padanam, bhumireva valambanam, Tvai jata paradhanam, Tvameva sharanam prabho, Govinda vallabhe radhe, Prarthaye tvamaham sada, Tvadiyam iti janatho, Govindo mam tvaya saha, Radha radita radhesha, Radhika prana vallabha, Radha ramana vanditvam, Radhika prema nirjita.
So, I apologize for the few minutes delay in starting the class, and I also welcome all the devotees who have joined us today online. I am eternally grateful to all of you for tolerating me and for allowing me to serve you. Though I am a low-class, sinful person, it's my good fortune that I have the opportunity to serve wonderful, exalted souls like your good self. Please forgive me for any offenses and shortcomings. So today we'll be doing the 17th chapter. Any questions? Any concerns? Because I think we should be able to cover the chapter today. But do you have any questions before we started? Maybe for 5 to 10 minutes, then we can take. If not, we can directly get into the 17th chapter. You're all okay? Okay. So in the 16th chapter, in the end, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, what does he talk about in the 16th chapter? Divine and demoniac. He starts with the divine qualities or the demoniac qualities? Divine qualities. Then he goes into the demoniac qualities. And we discussed how the demons have a very different kind of mindset, that they feel that there is no God in control, and they are somehow the controllers and the enjoyers. And in the end, actually it boils down to the fact that they do not believe in any form of scriptural injunctions. They have no regard for any. And we see that quite often when we meet friends, relatives or colleagues or somebody, and you say that, hey, there is God and this is a holy book, and they say, we don't care. You know, this is all bogus, hocus pocus or mythology or, you know, plain backward thinking. So many things they use, they just disregard them. While in the Kali Yuga, I read it somewhere, and I need to find the quote, so I'm giving the disclaimer right up front. But in Satya Yuga, the demons were staying on a different planet. And then the earth was just inhabited by very pious and demigod-like people, and they would come and attack. So they would be, demons would be on a different planet, and the devotees would be on a different planet. And in the Treta Yuga, the demons were there in the same planet, but very different locations. And the example is given, like Ravana was staying actually in Lanka, whereas Ram was in Ayodhya. And in Dwapara Yuga, they started staying together, like the Kauravas and the Pandavas, kind of. That was the example that was given. Again, I want to put the disclaimer, I read it somewhere, I don't know the quote, I don't even know if it is proper, but in Kali Yuga, the demons and the divine stay in just in the same body. So we see that the people are influenced by the demoniac natures, by the association they keep. So the bottom line that came to between the demons and the divine was that the demons did not believe in scriptural injunctions, whereas the devotees did. Arjuna's question is very interesting in the 17th chapter. So we'll get into Arjuna's question, what exactly he meant. He asked, Hare Krishna, Mahaprabhu, kindly repeat after me the first verse. Arjuna vacha, ye shastra vidimutsrijya, yajante shraddhayanvitaha, tesham nishtatuka krishna, satvam aho rajastamaha.
Arjuna inquired, O Krishna, what is the situation of those who do not follow the principle of scripture but worship according to their own imagination? Are they in goodness, in passion, or in ignorance?
Thank you. It's a very interesting question. Right? So, if you say the Vedic injunctions, how many people actually know Vedic injunctions? Yet we see all around that the people are worshipping. Yes or yes? They are doing some sort of worship. Since most of you are from India, Victoria, you may not know this, But in India, actually, they worship a particular sports person as God. And it's pretty serious. And in some cases, they actually worship a film actor in South India as actress as a god. And if you think it is just mere sentiment, actually they built a big temple and installed the form of that actress and offered daily puja. And Srila Prabhupada also mentions some worship like that in one of the purports, but we will get to that. So the actors and then the sports persons, like they do it in Western, like rock stars and such, people worship and adore them. So what sort of worship is this? So people do worship something. And then Arjuna's question is, what sort of worship is this? I mean, are they even somewhere related to? Because nowhere in the Vedas it's mentioned you should worship the best sports person or your favorite actress. Or your favorite politician, they actually did that. The present Prime Minister of India, the overzealous followers became so infatuated with that person, they actually wanted to build a temple. And fortunately, he has some little sense, he stopped it. They were about to do it actually. They wanted to acquire land somewhere in Gujarat to actually build it. So in any case, so Arjuna's question is pretty interesting. Let's read a purport a little bit. Srila Prabhupada gives some big picture there, and let's get some finer points. Purport, in the fourth chapter, 39th verse, it is said that a person faithful to a particular type of worship gradually becomes elevated to the stage of knowledge and attains highest perfectional stage of peace and prosperity. In the 16th chapter, it is concluded that one who does not follow the principles laid down in the scriptures is called an asura, demon. One who follows the scriptural injunctions faithfully is called deva or demigod. Now, if one with faith follows some rules which are not mentioned in the scriptural injunctions, what's his position? This doubt of Arjuna's is to be cleared by Krishna. Are those who create some sort of god by selecting a human being and placing their faith in him, worshipping in goodness, passion or ignorance? Do such persons attain the perfectional stage of life? Is it possible for them to be situated in real knowledge and elevate themselves to the highest perfectional stage? Do those who follow the rules and regulations of scriptures, but who have faith in something and worship gods and demigods and men attain success in their effort? Arjuna is putting these questions to Krishna. Interesting questions. One of those purports where it is filled with questions rather than answers. Usually purport, the very definition of purport is to clarify something. But in this definition, Srila Prabhupada is giving more and more questions. But he is just paraphrasing Arjuna. So, text 2, kindly repeat after me. Sri Bhagavan Uvacha. Trivida bhavati shraddha, dehinam sasvabhavaja, satviki rajasi chaiva, tamasi cheti tam shrunu.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, according to the three modes of nature acquired by the embodied soul, one's fate can be of three kinds, in goodness, in passion, or in ignorance. Now hear about this.
Thank you, Balaram. Text 3. Sattvanurupa sarvasya. Shraddha bhavati bharata, shraddha mayo yam purusho, yo yat shraddha sa eva saha.
O son of Bharata, according to one's existence under the various modes of nature, one evolves a particular kind of faith. The living being is said to be of a particular faith according to the modes he has acquired.
Thank you. So here, What is faith? Faith is something that a person not only believes in, but actually acts upon it. Yes or yes? A person who has faith in something, irrespective of what it is, they act on it. And they ultimately have to take the shelter of faith. Even the so-called scientists who don't believe in God, who don't believe in any higher power, they still act by faith, but they don't know it. Here is how. Did we all study about atom? What is there in an atom? Yes, Balram wants to answer that. I will give it to my chance. Nucleus and what? Okay, but did you see it? Then how do you know it is they exist? But you didn't see it, right? What's that? But the point is, you did not see it now, but you accepted it as truth. Yes or yes? That's my point. What was the basis of accepting that? Faith. And if you ask any scientist who doesn't believe in God whether they believe in electron, neutron, and proton, they'll say absolutely, as if it's like some Vedic truth that's never going to change forever. But when you ask them, did you actually see it? No. But so basically, a scientist has faith in other scientists. If you are driving on the road, and if you don't have faith, then you see a red light, you will say, I don't have faith in that red light. I'll just go past it. Or in other words, I don't have faith in anybody who drives. So you know what? This is a dangerous place. I'll never drive in my life. Just think about it. I have no faith in other drivers. I have no faith in the whole system of the red lights and green lights and traffic rules of California. Would you ever drive? So when you start off, when you say, how do you know it works? See, the point here is, faith is more pervasive than you think, and it is less accepted than you think. If you say to the scientists, you are a man of faith, they'll take offense, especially the atheistic scientists. Right? Man of faith, it seems to be, is man or women, with all due respect. It seems to be related only to, or qualified or limited only to a religion. I'm a man of faith. But sir, you are also a man of faith. You don't know it. And please imagine, every knowledge we acquire, we take it on faith. Imagine if every child in every school starts saying, prove what you are saying to the teacher. Will ever there be a transmission of knowledge? Because the teacher himself or herself cannot prove. They learned it from somewhere else. So the point here is, Shraddhomayam Purusha is a very important phrase, that when you say Gunamai, means you are filled with gunas. When you say Dhanamai or Dhanamaya, means you have that quality, that inherent quality of dhana. Shraddhomayam Purusha means a living entity is sustained on faith. What sort of faith? Krishna says, that depends on what mode of nature you are stuck in. But you have to have faith. A child will have faith that his parents will take care of him, yes or yes. It's a natural, most logical, even amongst animals. Imagine if the child says, I don't have faith in my parents. And in fact, there are cases where the child is abused and they show that tendency, they have no faith. Imagine how life will be so terrible. So faith is inbuilt. And Krishna is pointing it, Shraddhomayam Purusha means that a living entity survives only on faith. Now, if your faith is just placed in matter, then the results are different versus your faith is placed in a higher situation. So. Yeah, it's pretty interesting. Let's, for those who just joined online, we are on the verse number 3rd of the 17th chapter, and we are about to read the second paragraph of that purport. A little bit.
Everybody is there? The word Shraddha?
Okay. Thank you, Sridhar.
The word Shraddha or faith is very significant in this verse. Shraddha or faith originally comes out of the mode of goodness. One's faith may be in a demigod or some created god or some mental concoction. One's strong faith is supposed to be productive of the works of material goodness. But in material conditional life, no works are completely purified. They are mixed. They are not in pure goodness. Pure goodness is transcendental. In purified goodness, one can understand the real nature of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As long as one's faith is not completely in purified goodness, the faith is subject to contamination by the modes of nature. So, Krishna is saying that your faith will develop based on the modes of material nature, and when you cultivate the mode of goodness, then your faith will be equally finer and placed in a proper position. But if you are in the mode of ignorance and in the mode of passion, then your faith is different, and its faith in, it's diverted to a different angle. We'll continue what I mean by that in the next verse. Text 4, kindly repeat after me.
Yajante sattvika devan yaksharakshamsi rajasah pretan bhutaganamschanye yajante tamasa janah.
Men in the mode of goodness worship the demigods, those in the mode of passion worship the demons, and those in the mode of ignorance worship ghosts and spirits.
Thank you. Let's read the purport a little bit, the first paragraph, just the first paragraph. In this verse, the Supreme Personality of Godhead describes different kinds of worshippers according to their external activities. According to scriptural injunction, only the Supreme Personality of Godhead is worshipable. But those who are not very conversant with or faithful to the scriptural injunctions worship different objects according to their specific situations in the mode of material nature. Those who are situated in goodness generally worship the demigods. The demigods include Brahma, Shiva, and others such as Indra, Chandra, and the sun god. There are various demigods. Those in goodness worship a particular demigod for a particular purpose. Similarly, those who are in the mode of passion worship the demons. We recall that during the Second World War, a man in Calcutta worshipped Hitler because thanks to that war, he had amassed a large amount of wealth by dealing in the black market. Similarly, those in the modes of passion and ignorance generally select a powerful man to be God. They think that anyone can be worshipped as God and that the same results will be obtained. So, quick question. So, you know, this is not new. So, worshipping sports persons or actresses or powerful politicians. But in any case, it's just very perverted. People who have no idea. Please understand, the jiva has to worship or offer or adore. It's the nature. You recall, we go back to the very beginning, the introduction of the Bhagavad Gita. If you have not read it, my humble request, please read it if you have time. It's about 30 to 40 pages, but it's very profound. We are all atmas or spirit souls. Yes or yes? What is that one quality of atma that cannot be removed from the spirit soul? I'll give an example before you answer. And those who know, you know, you can answer it later. All right. For example, what is one quality of sugar? So if I give Balram some substance and I'll say, Balram, this is sugar, but actually it turns to be pretty salty. And I say to Balram, how is the sugar? And what will Balram say? It's not sugar. Yes or yes? Because sweetness is that defining quality or inseparable
or inalienable quality of sugar, without which sugar has no meaning or existence. For the spirit soul, what is that one quality that you remove that from the spirit soul, it's inseparable, you can't remove it. Consciousness, okay. Service. Thank you. And Srila Prabhupada writes extensively, you know, the politicians, they say that they feel they are the kings, but actually they say we are serving the people. A man is serving his family, a businessman is serving his customers. In this way, the service is something which is very, very inseparable. So when you are in the modes of nature of passion and ignorance, you still want to serve, but you don't know whom to serve. Therefore, you end up seeing, oh, there is this powerful person, he must be God, let me serve him. Or at least mentally, if you can't approach. So, please understand, well, what is the difference, you know, that man is having faith, he's worshipping a cricketer or a sports person or somebody. Some people worship their own wife, husband, or whatever. Not bad. And if qualifiedly they are not bad. Worshipping husband and wife. But the problem is, Krishna says in the 14th chapter, those who are situated in the mode of goodness, after they die, where do they go? Uppers. Those who are in the mode of passion? And those in the mode of ignorance? So same thing happens. So if you are in the mode of ignorance and you worship some ghosts and demons, how is it possible that after death you will go back to Godhead or to heavenly planets? It's just not logical. So, yes, so the spirit soul wants to serve because that's the nature, but because you are in the mode of ignorance, you serve something which is not worthy of service. Similarly, this man served Hitler. Hey, he's there. I'm not making it up. Abhishek, yes. You have to use the mic. There will be...
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, recently there was an article where when Maggie came back, people wrote lyrics glorifying Maggie. Aarti was there.
Maggie? Well, it's just the nature of the soul, because the soul has to survive on something. Maggie is my object that gives me life. So Maggie comes back. That's, I didn't know that. Thank you for bringing it up. Maggie Puja. Now let's do Maggie Puja. Maggie Aarti. And we'll offer cooked Maggie to Maggie. Yes, somebody had a question. Thank you. Abhishek, anything else you had? Thank you. Yes, Kuladvipa Prana Prabhu.
So here we see Prabhu, you know, the people who are in mood of goodness, they worship the demigods. But some people also worship like some false incarnation of Lord. So how do we categorize them? They are in mood of passion or ignorance?
So usually they are in the mode of passion because Krishna is not pleased with those who claim to be incarnations of God. And we can see from Krishna book the story of King of Paundra? Paundraka. So he claimed to be God himself. And then he everybody knows the story? Yes, for those who don't know. So there was one king called Paundraka. And then... Actually, if I remember right, his minister started saying that Krishna, that Yadava, who is in Dwarka, he's a cowherd boy. He's not actually God. You are God. And the ministers start daily giving him a small dose every day. You are God. You are God. And then they start going out to the city of Pundraka and then start telling everybody, he is God, he is God, he is God. That Vasudeva Krishna is a cheater, he's a false god, he should be rejected. And goaded by his ministers and everybody, actually the king of Paundraka, what is his name? Paundraka? Paundraka, right?
So Pavundraka, he thinks he is God. And then he says to his messenger, you go to Dwarka, you tell Krishna that actually he is a false god, I am the actual god, he should return back all my chakra, my symbol, insignia and everything back. And then, actually he starts behaving like that. He starts dressing up like Krishna, he starts putting on crown with peacock feather, he starts going around with flute in his hand. Krishna never does it in Dwarka though. But he starts taking flute around in his hand and he really believes he's God. And all he needs is from the fake God to return his... And then the messenger goes to Krishna and Krishna says, sure, I'll give my chakra and everything. Tell him to meet in the battlefield. And then, you know, Pavundraka comes with all his army assembled and everything. And Krishna comes alone on a Garuda. And Krishna comes... And then he comes alone on a Garuda. And then, he's not angry. Krishna is not angry seeing Pavundraka. He's laughing. He's like, it's like a big joke for him. His hasya ras is at the peak. It's like truly, you know, imagine the small feeling is like if you have like a 4 or 5 year old son and then, you know, you have this big truck that you drive and he says, no, I can drive the truck, please give me. Well, what would you say? You would just laugh at him. You wouldn't get angry, right? So Krishna was laughing and laughing and all the while he was just shooting arrows and he was laughing at the same time. And then and all his army was destroyed. He said, oh, Pavundraka, you wanted my insignia and my mace and everything. Here, take it. And he starts hitting at it. And the chakra goes, cuts off his head, and then goes back. So the problem, point is that those who claim themselves to be God, Krishna is not very pleased. They are just demons. That's the nature of demons. They somehow or other want to usurp the position of God, usurp the position of God. And so they are in mode of passion. Seriously, they are in mode of passion. Because actually it's very demoniac even to call yourself God. And then you have followers who worship you. Oh, Krishna, let's stop it at that. Can't even think further. Yes, you had a question, Maha, yes.
On page 685, at the first paragraph, it says, the demigods include Brahma, Shiva, and other, such as Indra, Chandra, and the sun god. I've heard many times that, like, Shiva is not a demigod. He's, like, in a different stage.
Mm-hmm.
Like, can you elaborate or specify that?
Sure. So it's said in Brahma Samhita, Kshiram yata dadivikara vishesha yogat sanjayate nahi tata pratagasti heto yaha shambhutam apitata sambhupaiti karyat govindam adipurushantum aham jami. So, Krishna is in a different category, yes. Shiva is in a different category, but please understand that the Sadashiv, who is an eternal associate of Krishna, he is in the Rudra Tattva. Sometimes the Shiva who destroys this world during devastation can be a Jiva. The incarnations of Shiva can be a Jiva. So Shiva is not one singular entity or personality. It's a Tattva, Rudra Tattva. It is called the Rudra Tattva. It's a truth, it's a category of truth. So the Sadashiv is definitely not a Jiva, is definitely not equal to Vishnu Tattvas. He's in a category of his own. But from him comes many Shivas who are capable of destroying the world. And sometimes they can be Jivas, and sometimes they can be his own Rudra Tattva. So in that sense, they are categorized as demigods. Please understand that the demigods are Jivas, but they are extremely empowered by Krishna to the extent that they are non-different from Krishna in their capacity to perform certain duties. Lord, in many places it is mentioned by the followers, they worship Lord Brahma as all in all. But Brahma says, no, I am not all in all. There is a
power higher above me. And so the demigods, though they are jivas, they should be respected as a very, very confidential servants of Krishna. In fact, today in Bhakti Vaibhava class, we were reading about Lord Brahma and his problem to solve. The problem he had to solve was there was nothing, he had to create something. And how it was, how he worshipped, he had no idea where he was or what his duty was. And he worshipped or meditated on Lord Vishnu for about 1,000 years of demigods. And then Lord Vishnu was pleased with him, he revealed himself. And then he gave those 4 verses, the Chatushloki Bhagavatam. And he empowered him. And because he was so dear to Krishna, he was so pleased, Lord Vishnu was so pleased with Brahma, he is, though a jiva, we respect him as the first recipient or the spiritual master in our line. And that. So, does that a little bit answer your question?
Yes, Prabhu, thank you so much.
Thank you. More questions, comments? Yes, Balaram.
So, like, as Kuladi Prana Prabhu said about, like, that they worship, like, the different types of demigods and all that, so, and incarnations, false incarnations of Krishna. So, like, sometimes people worship Buddha, but not as an incarnation of Krishna. What type of mode of is that?
Good question. So, Lord Buddha is obviously an incarnation of Krishna, as we know. But Rupa Goswami says in the Nectar of Devotion that Buddha came for a very specific purpose, that is to re-establish the non-violence and stop the rampant killing of animals. Do you know why he came, right, Victoria? So he came for a specific purpose, and to suit his purpose, he said, I don't believe in the Vedic authority. So, but the deeper meaning of Buddha's incarnation is that he came even to reclaim the atheistic people who didn't believe in the Vedas. At least, okay, it's like, you know undercover cops? Yes or yes? Okay. Undercover cops, are they bad guys or good guys? But they act like? So that the bad guys can trust them and reveal information. Same was with Buddha. He came, he decried the authorities of Vedas to stop the animal killing, but at the same time to reclaim those who didn't even believe in the authority of Vedas. At least it's better that those who don't believe in anything worship Buddha, because he's closer. But if you are a Vaishnava, then you don't really seriously take Buddha's instructions that seriously. But we worship, we respect him. We sing, right? Even in the Dashavatara, we just don't push Buddha's stanza outside. Oh, Buddha, no, we shouldn't sing that prayer. Nindasi yajna vide raha shruti jatam. Yes? Okay. Does that a little bit answer your question? Balaramji? Thank you. Mike?
So what mode of are they in? If someone is worshipping Buddha, what mode are they in? Are they in mode of ignorance?
Or depends, because it depends on how you see Buddha. If you see Buddha as a great man, then you are in the mode of passion. At least you are worshipping some legitimate form of Vishnu. Eventually you will go there, but after quite some time.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you. Because even the followers of Buddhists are pretty, you know, depends. Some are actually in mode of goodness. They really, very strictly, they don't do any non-violence. They absolutely don't eat meat. Onion, garlic also they don't eat. So it depends. Same with the demigods. Like people, they eat so many things, different things, and worship Shiva, they are in mode of passion and they worship Lord Shiva. though technically speaking, it's not black and white. Oh, you are in the mode of goodness. Okay, you have to worship demigods. You are in the mode of passion. Only pick up superstars and actresses or rock stars. You're in the mode of goodness. What are you doing here? You should be in cemetery worshipping ghosts. Crematoriums. Go to crematoriums. Because earlier we read, the mode of passion, there is always, between the modes, there is always competition. So you see, it's very dynamic. Thank you. Any other questions? All right. Text 5 and 6.
Ashastravihitam ghoram. Tapyante ye tapo janaha. Dambahankara samyuktaha. Kamaraga balanvitaha. Karshayanta sharirastham. Bhuta gramam achetasaha. Mam chaivanta sharirastham. Tan vidya sura nischayan.
Those who undergo severe austerities and penances not recommended in the scriptures, performing them out of pride and egoism, who are impelled by lust and attachment, who are foolish and who torture the material elements of the body as well as the super soul dwelling within, are to be known as demons.
Thank you. And there are many cases here. And if you read the purport, the common way, in the previous days, it was like, you know, we had people like Hiranyakashipu and others who performed like severe austerities. In the modern times, we have people who fast on the political basis. If the government doesn't agree to my proposal, and then I'll fast on to death. Yeah, right?
Yeah.
And then there is one person who's been from the, I don't want to name anything, but from the eastern part of India, who has been fasting for the last 40 years or so, didn't take anything. 40 years. Huh? Yeah, I'm not joking. Her name is Iram, I-R-O-M, Iram Sharmila or something like that. So she's from Assam, and the government forces send people who come, the soldiers who committed atrocities, and against that she did. For the last 40 years she has been not doing. Some silene she has. And you can look it up. I'm not making it up. Yeah, Krishna says, just imagine this torturing your body for some really like mundane purpose like that. I read that and I was like shocked. Yes, Balaram, you had a specific comment or a question?
In like the last U.S. election, like on the news, I saw this video of this person, the news people, they were interviewing her and they asked, like, who do you think will win? And she's like, Obama will win. If he doesn't win, I'll do the Gandhi fast.
Right. So, you know that Gandhi also fasted? Maybe you're too young to know all those things.
No, I didn't hear what you said.
Oh, Gandhi. No, Gandhi. He fasted for about 2 months or so. So please don't, even in our spiritual life also, we should take care that we don't whimsically fast. Whimsically, you know, take some vows to say that I'll just fast for the sake of fasting. Or fast for the sake of reducing weight. Or fast for, somehow or other, do for something. Don't. Eat regulated, eat in a controlled way, eat as much as possible, eat prasadam. Because by eating, the very act of eating prasadam actually satisfies the super soul from within. Because Krishna himself says in the third canto, when the Kumaras come, he says that the Vedic mantras, the utterance of Vedic mantras and other rituals doesn't satisfy me as much as when I see my brahmanas eating and I eat through their mouth. So since we are devotees, we should take care that our very act of eating also pleases Krishna if it's done in the right way. And here, torturing the indwelling super soul, he is not tortured, but he is just at a pain to see you like that. Just imagine a mother seeing her child fast. It's not like mother will eat, but she'll be internally unhappy. Or, you know, that is a picture. It's not like the God needs to eat food from within. If I don't eat, he will starve to death or something like that. That's not the meaning. It's just giving pain to Krishna. Because Krishna is a maintainer. He says, Pitaham asya jagata mata dhata pitamaha. He says, I am the mother, I am the father, I am the grandsire. And if you willfully fast like that against scriptural injunctions, it gives pain to Krishna, gives dissatisfaction to him. Okay, let's get to the interesting part. On an Ekadashi, no less. Text 7. Aharastvapi sarvasya.
Aharastvapi sarvasya.
Trivido bhavati priyaha.
Trivido bhavati priyaha.
Yajnastapastatadanam.
Yajnastapastatadanam.
Tesham vedam imam shunu.
Tesham vedam imam shunu.
Even the food each person prefers is of three kinds, according to the three modes of material nature. The same is true of sacrifices, austerities and charity. Now we are of the distinctions between them.
Thank you. Which four categories does Krishna talk about? First?
Food.
Second?
Sacrifice.
Third?
Austerity.
Fourth?
Charity.
Thank you. So he will actually go step by step with each of them. Text 8.
Ayuhu sattva balarogya.
Ayuhu sattva balarogya.
Sukha priti vivardhanaha.
Sukha priti vivardhanaha.
Rasya snigdha sthira hridya.
Rasya snigdha sthira hridya.
Aharaha sattvika priyaha.
Aharaha sattvika priyaha.
Foods dear to those in the mode of goodness increase the duration of life, purify one's existence and give strength, health, happiness and satisfaction. Such foods are juicy, fatty, wholesome and pleasing to the heart.
Thank you. Text 9.
Katvam la lavanatyushna. Tikshna ruksha vidahinaha. Ahara raja sasyeshta.
Ahara raja sasyeshta.
Dukkha shokamaya pradaha.
Dukkha shokamaya pradaha.
Foods that are too bitter, too sour, salty, hot, pungent, dry and burning are dear to those in the mood of passion. Such foods cause distress, misery and disease.
Thank you. Text 10.
Yatayamam gatarasam.
Yatayamam gatarasam.
Bhuti paryoshitam chayat.
Bhuti paryoshitam chayat.
Uchishtam apichamedyam.
Uchishtam apichamedyam.
Bhojanam tamasapriyam.
Bhojanam tamasapriyam.
Food prepared more than 3 hours before being eaten. Food that is tasteless, decomposed and putrid, and food consisting of remnants and untouchable things is dear to those in the mood of darkness.
Thank you. So, Srila Prabhupada's purport is very nice. Couple of points. When we talk about fatty foods in the mode of goodness, it's not animal fat, but it's fat made of ghee and other things. The only exception to the food in the mode of passion or ignorance, which is food prepared more than 3 hours, Srila Prabhupada writes, is the prasadam. Even though prasadam is prepared earlier than 3 hours, we still can accept it because prasadam doesn't get decomposed like ordinary food. Otherwise, you shouldn't. Another point Srila Prabhupada writes is, at least those who eat remnants, the quality or the modes of the person who has eaten and after whom you eat their remnants gets infested in you. So it's important that you eat remnants only they are of really, exalted saints and spiritual master. And of course, the exalted devotees. But otherwise, you shouldn't. Especially the reason I bring it up is because in our office, at least, I don't know about other offices, we get emails. You know, there is a lunch that client comes or some conference or some training is going on. They order food and then they say, leftover foods, please come and eat. I was like, no, thank you. Because, you don't even eat prasadam, but even from the prasadam perspective, you still can buy food and eat, at least the karma is reduced, but to eat food in that connection is not at all advisable. Because the leftover food of people who have eaten is infested with their mentality. So you should avoid it. Makes sense? Yeah, because it's written here. Srila Prabhupada writes here. There is another point also that why don't I offer meat to God? So that's come up pretty much. We shall read the last paragraph and right in the middle. For those who joined online, we are reading the purport from the verse 10 of 17th chapter. The last 7, 8, 9, 10 lines maybe. The best food. Everybody there? Yeah. So, Sridhar Prabhu, yes, a little bit higher. Yes. Inka, a little bit more. The best food. Ah, yeah, is right there. Third line from the top. Excellent. Thank you. The best food is the remnants of what is offered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In the Bhagavad Gita, the Supreme Lord says that he accepts preparations of vegetables, flour, and meal when offered with devotion. Patram pushpam phalam toyam. Of course, devotion and love are the chief things which the Supreme Personality of Godhead accepts. But it's also mentioned that the prasadam should be prepared in a particular way. Any food prepared by the injunctions of scripture and offered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead can be taken even if prepared long, long ago because such food is transcendental. Therefore, to make food antiseptic, eatable and palatable for all persons, one should offer the food to the... So that's the only exception because people say, mode of goodness. Yes, Lakshmi had a question.
Prabhu, so here it's saying that you can't offer meat, but in temples, like many temples in India, why do they like offer animals and then in the name of like God or goddess, and then like devotees eat the meat?
Well,
it's like a tradition, right? So
I know. Please understand that in here the exact chapter says those who are in different faith, they sometimes create their own kind of concoction of worship. So animal sacrifice is forbidden in this age of Kali, more or less. But if you go against the scriptural injunctions, you do is disregard that, then you create your own method of worship. Your own. So if you have a sports star as your god, then what's stopping you from creating your own method of worship? Maybe I'll offer him a cigar and a beer instead of aarti and whatever, water. Hey, that's worshipping, he likes it. It's the same worship. God wants Sagarbati, I'll offer him a cigar. Who is stopping it? I make up my own worship. And he is satisfied, I am satisfied. We are okay. So, does that little bit answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah, there are some exceptions. There are some Stala Puranas which are specific to that places. Maybe they allow some sort of animal killing on some specific things. But, without getting into too much details, more often than not, I did hear about that. More often than not, it's just made up worship for our own sense gratification. They want to kill the animal,
but they don't want to take the sin. So they, in the name of God, you kill it, so there is no sin. So usually it boils down to that. Killing of animals is just for my own tongue. And God is there as kind of person who is going to save me from hell. At least it's little better. It's not condonable, but at least little better than people who wantonly eat meat with no question of, you know, restriction or anything. Make sense? Thank you. Other questions, comments? Yes, Kuladeva Prana Prabhu. Yeah.
So you discussed like Lord Buddha appeared to, you know, get rid of the concept of violence by using the Vedic injunctions, right? So we know that there are Puranas for those people who are in mood of ignorance.
Mm.
And mood of passion, mood of goodness. So mood of ignorance people, they are actually, they have that, you know, propensity to eat foods which are described here. It's like a stale and made of flesh and blood. So there are like injunctions in the Vedas also, like you can eat.
Correct.
Through certain procedure, right?
Yes.
Yeah, but that will also gradually, in a way that you will gradually come to a higher platform, right? So
correct.
So it doesn't kind like directly omit that you cannot eat meat, but there should be some procedure according to the Vedic.
Yes. Even in Bhagavatam, Narada says, he says, men, people are naturally inclined to eating meat, to intoxication and to women. But the scriptures are given in such a way, they regulate it not with a view to increase that desire, but to actually mitigate the desire as it goes down. Thank you, well put. But in the modern, the problem with the modern society is they have slaughterhouses which indiscriminately kill animals with no regards to their life. The only reason they kill is to make profit and to earn living. That sort of sinful thing is very, very harmful to the society. Yeah. All right, text 11. So the food is part is done. Let's go for the sacrifice part. Text 11. We have here, if you have joined, you can see it here. Can you see it? All right, thank you. Text 11. Afala kankshi bir yagnyo. Vididishtoya ijyate. Yashtavyam eveti manaha. Samadhayasa sattvikaha.
Of sacrifices, the sacrifice performed according to the directions of scripture as a matter of duty by those who desire no reward is of the nature of goodness.
Thank you. So what are the three qualifications if you want to perform sacrifice in the mode of goodness? Direction of scriptures. Desire, desire, no reward. And those who are in the mode of passion, what do they do? Text 12. Abhisandayatu phalam. Dambartam apichaivayat. Ijyate bharata shreshta. Tam yajnam vidhirajasam.
But the sacrifice performed for some material benefit or for the sake of pride, O chief of the Bharatas, you should know to be in the mode of passion.
Thank you. Text 13. Vidihinam asrishtanam. Mantrahinam adakshinam. Shraddha virahitam yajnam. Tamasam parichakshate.
Any sacrifice performed without regard for the direction of scripture, without distribution of prasadam, spiritual food, without chanting of the Vedic hymns and remunerations to the priest, and without faith is considered to be the mode, in the mode of ignorance.
Thank you. So what are we discussing here? Faith, right? I mean the mode of nature, but mainly the faith. You know what's the ironic thing? If you read the purport, faith in the mode of darkness or ignorance is actually faithlessness. I mean, we are talking of faith, but Krishna himself, he says in the verse, Shraddha Virahitam, means without faith. So that faithlessness is actually the faith of those who are in ignorance. Makes sense? It's contradictory. We are talking of faith, but there is no faith. And that kind of no faith is actually the faith of those who are in the mode of darkness or ignorance. They are doing stuff but with no clue. And one of the examples is this modern marriages where you would go to the court for civil union, where a man and woman, in this case, in this country, a man and man, or a woman and woman, they go to the court for civil union to get married. There is absolutely no question of following the Vedic rituals there. Neither is there any sort of yajna, any priest, any remuneration, prasadam distribution. Yeah, right. Maybe they are taking some sort of intoxicants just to do a hi-fi after that, whatever. And there is no faith. Why are you getting married? It's just like, you know, who cares? We just like this before marriage and now no big deal at all. So where is your faith in marriage? Virahitam, shraddha virahitam, there is no faith. Yes, Ashok ji had a question. No? Okay. Yes, Lakshmi.
So, Prabhu, many times, like in stories, and like we read that, like some priest or sage comes to advise, like gives advice to a king, like perform this so you can get this in turn. Like even though the instruction is coming from like exalted devotee, and but they still perform the sacrifice in like to get something in return. What mode would that be like?
It's, they're getting. Krishna says in the mode of passion, says there is, you perform that ritual for some material benefit. We read it in the previous verse.
But they're following the instructions of like.
True, mm-hmm. True. For example, in some case, the so-called material benefit may not actually be material benefit. I'll tell an example. Maharaj Dashrath, did he perform a sacrifice? What was the purpose of his sacrifice? Wasn't that a material benefit? Was Vasishtha a bona fide devotee? Why did he advise Maharaj Dashrath to do something that is in the mode of passion? Yes, Balaram has an answer. Exactly. So it's part of, so when you do the same sacrifice, though there is a material benefit, but you do it as a duty. When Maharaj Dashrath, when he performed the sacrifice, were the priests there? Was it performed according to the instructions of Vedas? Where was there prasadam distribution? Were the priests given remuneration? Did he do it out of duty or did he do it out of his own, desire? Because he was very old by that time. He really had no desire to have, if he wanted to have children just out of his own ego, he could have done it when he was young. But the kingdom needs to be taken care of. One of the king's biggest responsibilities was to ensure that there was a successor so that the kingdom is taken care of. So, yes, so we see that sacrifices happen, but they are not purely for sense enjoyment or false ego. In some cases, there was more than that. But if you do it like that, yes, it's in the mode of passion. Oh, yeah, I can do this sacrifice. What's the big deal? I have a lot of money. I'll throw some money at the priests. They'll come. They'll do it. And I'll get to invite all my friends, and they'll see how big I am, you know, how great of a sacrifice I have done. So that in the mode of passion. Make sense? Okay, we are good on time. Are we done with the ijjate or sacrifice? And then we'll go to the austerity or penance. Text 14, first Krishna describes penance by body, mind and words, and then we'll go to the other aspect of it.
Devadvija Guru Prajna Pujanam Saucham Arjavam Brahmacharyam Ahimsacha Shariram Tapa Uchyate.
Austerity of the body consists in worship of the Supreme Lord, the Brahmanas, the spiritual master and superiors like the father and mother, and in cleanliness, simplicity, celibacy and non-violence.
Thank you. Text 15. Anudvegakaram vakyam satyam priyahitam chayat Svadhyaya Abhyasanam Chaiva Vanmayam Tapa Uchyate.
Austerity of speech consists in speaking words that are truthful, pleasing, beneficial and not agitating to others, and also in regularly reciting Vedic literature.
Thank you. So Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport, it's you get some instructive points from there. Purport, one should not speak in such a way as to agitate the mind of others. Of course, when a teacher speaks, he can speak the truth for the instruction of his students, but such a teacher should not speak to those who are not his students if he will agitate their minds. This is penance as far as talking is concerned. Besides that, one should not talk nonsense. The process of speaking in spiritual circles is to say something upheld by the scriptures. One should at once quote from a scriptural authority to back up what he is saying. At the same time, such talk should be very pleasurable to the ear. By such discussions, one may derive the highest benefit and elevate human society. There is a limitless stock of Vedic literature, and one should study this. This is called the penance of speech, and which you are all doing by taking Bhakti Shastri. Because you're studying the Vedic literature, and that's penance of speech. So please understand, speech doesn't only mean one way out. It means I speak and the words flow out. But even what I take in is also penance of speech. Make sense? Because Krishna himself says Svadhyaya, means studying of the Vedic literatures. Text 16.
Manah prasada saumyatvam maunam atma vinigraha bhava samshuddhiritetat tapo manasamuchyate.
And satisfaction, simplicity, gravity, self-control and purification of one's existence are the austerities of the mind.
Thank you, Mother Govind Prabhu. Here, people are searching for satisfaction. Yes or yes? Part, Krishna says, but that satisfaction is actually an austerity if you need to exert it in a right way. Because most of the times, people are not happy with what they get. They are not satisfied, and they want more. If they had followed this path of austerity, the consumer market would be dead by now. Seriously, every year, do you really need a new iPhone? Or that in every 4 years, you really got to have that new model car? Now, I'm sure the manufacturers will say 4 years is too much. Let's make every 2 years. But if you are satisfied with what you have, Krishna says it's an austerity. It's not like, you know, to think, I get that, I'll get, I get that position, that bank balance, that whatever you want to call it, that will make me happy. Krishna says sometimes the satisfaction is forced because it's an austerity to be satisfied. But that austerity in the long run is actually going to help. Does that make sense? Satisfaction, Krishna says, you have to work for it, at least mentally. Otherwise, if you give in to your mind, mind will not be stopped at anything. Even if you get the whole world, the mind will say, I need the Indra's planet. Why is Indra having it? I need Indra's planet now. There is no limit to where the mind can go and get stuff in this world, even if it gets everything it wants. 99.99% of the time, people don't have that much pious karma to get everything that they want. Only few people get so much of wealth and opulence and possessions and power for a long time, for one life. It's even rare this time. But if the mind is not satisfied, you'll never be happy. You get it, you'll be happy. You'll be unhappy. Even if you don't get it, you'll be unhappy. Lakshmi had questions. Today she's asking a lot of questions. I'm so happy.
This is a comment.
Okay, go for it.
So we were talking about this. There's this word to define it. It's called a hedonic treadmill, and it's where the mind, like when it gets certain object, it adapts to that. Like it's happy, and then adapts to that. And to get the same amount of happiness, it needs something more than that. So it keeps adapting and wanting more. And so at one point, it takes like so much to make get same amount of happiness that it started out with.
Excellent. One point on that, just to alleviate the concerns of the parents who have their children in the audience. If you have to train hard for an exam, then you have to train. And then you cannot simply say, I'll be satisfied with F grade. That's mentally satisfied right now. No, try for the best, but whatever Krishna wants will happen. Because this Bhagavad Gita was actually spoken. Again, the context, if we go back, the war was about to start. And Arjuna was actually quite satisfied. He said, I'll go back to forest, let the Kauravas rule the kingdom. But Krishna is inciting him to fight. So, satisfaction of mind cannot be construed as a fact like, you know, chalta, whatever is it, I have no standards or I don't want to aspire for something. But at the same time, from the material perspective, you just have to. All right, let's move on. Text 17. Shraddhaya paraya taptam. Tapastat trividham naraihi. Afala kankshi bhir yuktai. Sattvikam parichakshate.
This threefold austerity performed with transcendental faith by men, not expecting material benefits, but engaged only for the sake of the Supreme, is called austerity in goodness.
Thank you. Text 18. Satkaramana pujartham. Tapo dambena chaivayat. Kriyate tad iha proktam. Rajasam chalamadhruvam.
Penance performed out of pride and for the sake of gaining respect, honor, and worship is said to be in the mode of passion. It is neither stable nor permanent.
Thank you, Mataji. So if you perform penance out of mode of passion, what are the reasons you perform? Three: gaining respect, honor, and worship. And is that permanent? It's extremely flickering, because that penance cannot be sustained in the long run. You will just do it for some time and then it's gone, lost. More often than not, you get that worship or whatever you desire because you are doing it with certain desire. And when you get it, will you do it? Probably not. And if you don't get it, will you have the same faith in it? Probably not. Text 19. Thank you, Mayapur Prabhu. Really appreciate it. Mudagrahenatmanoyat Pidaya Kriyate Tapaha Parasyot Sadhanatamva Tattamasam Udahritam.
Penance performed out of foolishness with self-torture or to destroy or injure others is said to be in the mode of ignorance.
Thank you. Hiranyakashipu is the example given. He tortured his own body, and why did he perform that torture? To kill Vishnu. That's what we want. Text 20. Dātavyam iti yaddānam Diyate nupakārine Deshe kāle cha pātre cha Taddānam sātvikam smṛtam.
Charity given out of duty without expectation of return at the proper time and place and to a worthy person is considered to be in mode of goodness.
Thank you. So we have done with food, we have done with penance or austerities and sacrifices. Now the last item is charity. And charity is again same out of duty without expectation of return at a proper place, time, and worthy person. So five qualities are needed. Madhav Govind Prabhu had an observation or a question or some instruction for me. I'll take either ways.
I have a question. When we are discussing about the penance in the mode of ignorance and passion and goodness, at that time, in general, we say that devotional service, when we perform, it results in knowledge and detachment. And does that detachment, and we also hear the statement that if austerity performed, if it makes the hard heart-hearted, it's not the right austerity actually.
Mm.
And also we hear that ideally by performing austerity or devotional service, our heart has to become soft.
Mm.
So how does that, where does it happen that, or why does it happen that austerity goes in the, makes one's heart hard-hearted actually.
Two points, I mean, you asked two or three questions. So this particular chapter where Krishna is talking, we are still in the modes of nature. We haven't overcome them. And towards the end, he talks about linking all this to the higher purpose. So, austerity is enough itself is needed to control the mind. In devotional service, when you perform austerities for the sake of austerities, to either have this egoistic satisfaction that, you know, I have performed this austerity, I have been nirjal for last 10 years, I've been doing Nirjala Ekadashi for the last 10 years, or I can fast for the whole month of Kartik by breathing air only in Vrindavan or something like that, or drinking Ganga water in Mayapur, nothing else. The problem is, as we go in spiritual life, the matter or the detachment from matter becomes more of attachment to matter in relationship with Krishna. Any matter which is attached or used in service of Krishna, that is dear to me. But austerities means that you abstain from matter. And eventually it is incomplete, Because you see matter as different from Krishna. And because you are a jiva, you think I have controlled the matter. There is that subtle sense of false pride in you. And that anything that is even a relationship with Krishna, that becomes really like not so good. The example is, Mahaprabhu, after Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya was converted to Vaishnavism and he became a staunch follower of Mahaprabhu, one day Mahaprabhu visited him early in the morning. Every day morning he would go visit the temple of Lord Jagannath and he would take Mahaprasadam. And Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya, by that time, he is just arisen from the bed. And Mahaprabhu walked in and he gave him prasadam, Mahaprasadam from Lord Jagannath. And Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya, he didn't even think for a second. He just popped that Mahaprasadam right into his mouth. Please understand that Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya was not a freshman at Princeton University, raised in US. They can do that. And they would probably, they might even do that. Without brushing your teeth, you just eat whatever comes to your mind. Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya was a scholar. He was so learned in the Vedic way of life, and he was thoroughly knowledgeable with all the rules, regulations and everything. Previously, he wouldn't even touch food, leave alone eat, put it into his mouth before he actually took bath, did his puja, and you know, very pakka. Mahaprabhu was surprised. What did you do? You didn't even brush your teeth, you didn't even take bath. Because scriptures say that if you don't take bath and you eat food, then it's actually like eating an abominable substance. So, you didn't do anything. Then Sarvabhaum Bhattacharya quoted so many verses to glorify Mahaprasadam. He says, Mahaprasadam comes, you don't consider anything, you take it. So the softness of heart comes as we advance. The thing is, you cannot artificially get softness of heart. Actually, artificial softness of heart means uncontrolled mind. Saying that you have to be soft. I'll do all my nonsense, you be soft in your heart. So it will come automatically as we go. So that's the reason though. So you have to be soft, it goes, it comes. But if you are still on the path, niyamagraha, you know, that's the niyamagraha means I do only follow the rules for the sake of following. The rules are my life and soul. Love of Krishna, that's not so much. When you have that mentality, then you are stuck to the rules and you become very hard-hearted. And eventually you come to the point that compassion is lost. Those who are not following the rules that you are following to high standards, they are useless people. Unfit. So you see how that mind kind of, you know, if you cling on to that rules without knowing the higher purpose behind the rules, then, you know, you really become hard-hearted. More towards yourself, towards others, and even towards Krishna also you won't get that affinity. Of loving attachment. Sorry for the very long answer. Please forgive me. Thank you. Okay. We are on text 21, right? Yes, we didn't do that.
Yattu pratyupakarartham. Phalam uddishya va punaha diyate cha parikrishtam taddanam rajasam smritam.
But charity is performed with the expectation of some return, or with the desire for fruitive results, or in a grudging mood, is said to be charity in the mode of passion.
Thank you. Text 22.
Adesha kale yaddanam apatrebhyascha diyate asatkritam avagnyatam tattamasam udahritam.
Tattamasam udahritam.
and charity performed at an impure place, at an improper time to unworthy persons, or without proper attention and respect, is said to be in the mode of ignorance.
Thank you. So, let's read the purport. It's short, it's instructive, and I hope the devotees use that. Contributions for indulgence in intoxication and gambling are not encouraged here. That sort of contribution is in the mode of ignorance. Such charity is not beneficial, rather sinful persons are encouraged. Similarly, if a person gives charity to a suitable person, but without respect or without attention, that sort of charity is also said to be in the mode of darkness. So, you know, when the charity has to be discriminated to whom you are giving and what's your motive in giving. What is the charity likely to be used for? All those things are needed. Text 23.
Om Tat Sat Iti Nirdesho. Brahmanas Trividas Pritaha. Brahmanastena Vedascha. Yajnascha Vihitapura.
From the beginning of creation, the three worlds Om, Tat, Shat were used to indicate the Supreme Absolute Truth. These three symbolic representations were used by Brahmanas while chanting the hymns of the Vedas and during sacrifice for the satisfaction of the Supreme.
Thank you. So here, after mentioning all these things, now Krishna is linking up these activities, that if you somehow connect these activities to Supreme, at least in the mode of goodness, because if you are in the mode of goodness, then only you can connect it. Till now, he said that those who are in the mode of passion or mode of goodness worship, and mode of passion, demons, and those in the mode of ignorance worship the ghosts and the spirits. But here, Krishna is giving, you know, Shuddha Sattva Gun, or how even those activities can be dovetailed in service of Krishna. Text 24.
Tasmad om ityudahritya yajnadana tapakriyaha pravartante vidhanokta satatam brahmavadinam.
Therefore, transcendentalists undertaking performances of sacrifice, charity, and penance in accordance with the scriptural regulations, begin always with Om to attain the Supreme.
Thank you. Text 25.
Tad ityanabhi sandhaya phalam yajnatapakriyaha dana kriyascha vividaha kriyante moksha kankshibihi.
Without desiring fruitive results, one should perform various kinds of sacrifice, penance and charity with the word tat. The purpose of such transcendental activities is to get free from material entanglement.
There Krishna, here he gives even the charity and the food and everything, Krishna, he gives the higher purpose of that. Why do we do this? To get freedom from the material entanglement. If that purpose is not there, everything else is meaningless. Because you can have arguments with your friends and relatives and whoever, oh, why don't you guys eat meat? So the point is, if you don't have the higher purpose, there is no point even in arguing. Because you don't even understand what is the impact of what you eat and what you do and how you behave and how you associate, everything matters. How much charity you give, you know, what sort of penance, everything matters. And Krishna is linking up with that higher purpose.
Text 26 and 27. Sadbhave sadhu bhave cha. Sad ityetat prayujyate. Prashaste karmani tatha. Satchabda partha yujyate.
yajne tapasi dane cha sthiti sad iti ochate karma chaiva tadarthiyam sad ityeva vidiyate.
The absolute truth is the objective of devotional service, and it is indicated by the word sat. The performer of such sacrifice is also called sat, as are all works of sacrifice, penance and charity which, true to the absolute nature, are performed to please the Supreme Person, O Son of Pritha.
Thank you. Text 28.
अश्रद्धायाहुतं दत्तं तपस्तप्तं कृतं च यत् असद् इत्युच्यते पार्थ न च तत्प्रेत्य नो इह.
Anything done as sacrifice, charity, or penance without faith in the Supreme, O Son of Pritha, is impermanent. It is called asat and is useless both in this life and the next.
Thank you. Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Anything done without this transcendental objective, whether be it sacrifice, charity, or penance, is useless. Therefore, in this verse, it is declared that such activities are abominable. Everything should be done for the Supreme in Krishna consciousness. Without such faith and without proper guidance, there can never be any fruit. In all the Vedic scriptures, faith in the Supreme is advised. In the pursuit of all Vedic injunctions, the ultimate goal is the understanding of Krishna. No one can obtain success without following this principle. Therefore, the best course is to work from the very beginning in Krishna consciousness under the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master. That is the way to make everything successful. In the conditioned state, people are attracted to worshipping demigods, ghosts, or yakshas like Kuvera. The mode of goodness is better than the modes of passion and ignorance, but one who takes directly to Krishna consciousness is transcendental to all the three modes of material nature. Although there is a process of gradual elevation, if one, by the association of pure devotees, takes directly to Krishna consciousness, that is the best way. And that is recommended in this chapter. To achieve success in this way, one must find the proper spiritual master and receive training under his guide direction. Then one can achieve faith in the Supreme. When that faith matures, in course of time, it is called love of Godhead. This love is the ultimate goal of the living entities. One should therefore take to Krishna consciousness directly. That is the message of this seventh chapter. So Krishna 17th, thank you. So Krishna is giving the different modes of nature, but he's saying above all this is the worship of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And those who can directly worship, they transcend the modes of nature. Questions, comments, concerns? Yes, Mayapur Prabhu.
Just curious, Prabhu, in the last verse, anything done as a sacrifice without faith in the Supreme. I mean, we always see examples like, you know, people like the word Agyat Sukriti, they do help devotees or the Lord. Some of them just give charity, although their faith is either not there or very weak. But then it does help, right? So why is it said here? What is the context that's useless? I mean, it's pretty hard term out.
Usually those who are inclined to help, who are inclined to serve, they are at least in the mode of goodness. But when Krishna is talking about faith here, he's referring to actually those who are in the mode of darkness, who are in the tamasic stage. You know, for them, they might do so many so-called sacrifices, but it is usually, it's not going to add any benefit. There are many sects in India, I don't want to name, but they actually go to crematoriums and they live off of the dead bodies, half-burnt bodies, and they smoke all sorts of intoxicants. That's for them, it's a serious spiritual path that they are doing. So there are many paths like that, but Krishna says, if you don't have faith in me, then all those severe austerities are meaningless, because you will be contaminated. If you just imagine the contamination you get because of all those activities. So Ajnata Sukriti is in a different term. Usually, please understand, Mayapur Prabhu, that even the bhakti to touch someone, it is causeless. The Ajnata Sukriti, for those who are not familiar with the word Ajnata Sukriti, it is just some unknown past pious activities that has resulted in devotional service. Now, in the Madhurya Kadambani of Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur, he even discounts Ajnata Sukriti as the cause of bhakti. He says bhakti is so independent, so pure, and so powerful that she can give bhakti to anybody she chooses. And it's a fact. I mean, like when Srila Prabhupada came to US, the association of pure devotee was, you know, that was a very powerful thing. But because he prayed on their behalf, bhakti was ready to give them. Otherwise, till today they are, you know, we can see the stalwart devotees that still exist in the movement because of that mercy. So, this, more specifically, Krishna refers to the sacrifice, impermanent. So, for example, the other thing, what was the purpose of fasting for a political movement? There's absolutely no faith in Supreme there. It is just my own agenda that I have to show and get something from the world. It's really useless, because that world is not, forget the world, even that country you are going to fight for and fast for and kill yourself for, that won't be even be existing. So, that is a big picture. Of course, Krishna himself says, to counter your point, Mayapur Prabhu, Krishna himself says in the 12th chapter, what does he say? Always think of me. If you cannot, follow regulative principles. If you cannot do this, then work for me. If you cannot do this, so Krishna himself says, just do something for me, or something for my cause. So, it's not he's discounting it. But this is like really in the mode of darkness, asat. Is that a little bit helps? Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Yes, Srila Itamati.
Sorry. Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
So in the Thanksgiving season, which is next week kind of, right? So let's say when you donate to a local charity, so their goal is like, you know, feeding, example, 500 families, right? So when you donate some money to them, when we donate some money to them, and so they make sandwiches and they put either ham or meat as part of that sandwich, and they deliver that one, right? So which mode of the person who is donating, so in, based on today's chapter, right? So which mode of category?
Hard to tell. Depends. If you are expecting some return, so I donate to this charity, I'll get a tax break because it's the year end. You know, I'm getting some tax break, then it's in the mode of passion. But, I mean,
I'm asking more of if they put meat. Which
is actually, Srila Prabhupada clearly writes that don't. I mean, he actually. One point that struck me, even in the purport, it's a grey area. I'll first, philosophically, let's put it straight that we don't support it, you know, from our perspective. But if you are a lawyer, you can argue from Srila Prabhupada's purport itself. Srila Prabhupada forbids two types of charity in the mode of ignorance. He says gambling, he says intoxication. So if somebody comes to you and says, you know, we want to organize a trip to the bar or Napa Valley to drink a lot of wine, please give. So probably you wouldn't, you know, outrightly you refuse based on Prabhupada. But meat eating is it's a gray area. Ideally, we don't. But the point here is, again, we can argue based on Srila Prabhupada's book that when there was nothing to eat, Maharaj Prithu was ready to kill Mother Earth and feed the flesh of Mother Earth to those who were starving. So, if they are feeding to families who are like desperate and starving, and who, then we don't know. So it's a very gray area. But having said that, the generic principle is we don't. I wouldn't. If you ask me personally, I wouldn't. If I would know, I would like to know more about your charity, what sort of thing you do. Because in the name of feeding somebody, keeping alive, you are killing a whole bunch of animals. That itself is like, you know, even from the spiritual perspective aside, just from an ethical perspective, to kill someone to feed someone, it really doesn't add up. Yeah. So it's a gray area. Not a gray area, it's a gray but very close to black. Definitely not white. That's what I'm trying to say. Because if Srila Prabhupada had strictly said, you know, you never give to any charity which even works on that level, then we would definitely go for it. It's a black area. But he didn't mention there. So ideally you shouldn't. Or we can give to Food for Life. Ask that person who is giving that, give it to Food for Life. You know, we can distribute prasadam. If your heart is in like feeding poor, and that's your like, you know, that's what your wish is for your money, then give it Food for Life. No animals are killed in making this charity. They have that thing, right? Somewhere in the advertisement movies or something like that. No animals were harmed in the making of this movie. So we can say no animals were killed in making of this charity. Anything, Koladvi Prabhu, you had a question? No, Dheerajji had a question in the back. Is that okay? You decide who wants to go first. Okay, since you are both pointing to each other, I will go for you. With all due respect. He's initiated, so you will give him the first priority. From a spiritual etiquette perspective. Yes, spiritual etiquette. Okay,
thank you for seconding my thought.
Okay, thank you. If you get initiated also, then I won't come in between. It's between you and you. You can keep on fighting for the rest of 10-15 minutes.
But still the seniority will be the same.
That is something you decide, again. For now it's black and white case, after that it becomes a little grey.
I actually forgot about the question.
Okay, Dheeraj, you go. See,
this is the smartness.
No. I'm sure he actually forgot. Because in the DT, in front of the DT, you don't say that. So,
my question is pertaining to a couple classes ago, that day you had mentioned or shared many wonderful kathas, stories, and you had mentioned that after the war of Mahabharata, Arjun asked Krishna about his performance or his feedback, something on those lines, and Krishna was not satisfied. But then you mentioned that at that time Krishna told him some other story, which you didn't share. So.
Actually, I echoed your sentiment. So, for those who are not there, let me just refresh what Dheeraji is talking about. So, after Mahabharata war, Arjuna asks Krishna to repeat the whole Bhagavad Gita. He says, "You told me many wonderful instructions, but it was the heat of the battle, and I was emotionally not that great. And so, please tell me again." And then Krishna says, he is a little bit disappointed. He says, "Arjuna, that is the knowledge even the gods don't have access to, and I shared with you, and I'm a little disappointed that you don't remember what all I said. But I'll tell you some other story," and he told the story. I wish I had read the actual Mahabharata, 12 volumes, to tell you the story, but in the condensed version, that story is not mentioned. So when I get to the story, I'll definitely tell you. Yes, you had. You know what the story is?
No, not the story. I have a question.
Okay. Yes, Kolathi Prabhu remembers, so he gets.
So you are mentioning, Prabhu, you know, that we should consider the matters in relationship with Krishna, right? And we should take it in relationship with him, right? We should accept the prasadam, you know, sometimes we should accept, you know, luxury in relationship with Krishna. But we see like some Mahabhagavats, you know, they were so detached or so virakta, I like the term, yeah. So that they don't even, even eat very simple thing, and you know, they eat, in fact, externally it seems they are torturing themselves. But still they are like completely satisfied Atmarama and you know, in a different level. So like how we reconcile, like even though, you know, we know that, you know, everything is relationship with Krishna and they are in top class consciousness of that, yeah.
Did everybody get the question? Should I rephrase it? Okay. So Krishna says in this chapter that, you know, the penance in the mode of ignorance is torturing oneself and, you know, just having a cruel intention for others. And Koladvipa Prabhu's question is, we have seen exalted personalities who actually seems to be quote-unquote torturing themselves. The prime example is Shukdev Goswami. He did not even wear clothes. He just drank cow's milk. He was just roaming about with specifically no aim. Was he not torturing himself? He left his body to wind and to cold. The short answer to that is, we are talking of modes of nature here, but those personalities were above the modes of material nature. So they were situated in their pure self. In the pure self, the body really does not feel the need for eating, because there is, the body is not, is there as an external manifestation, but the actual spiritual power within is what that sustains the body. Like Krishna, Krishna does not need to eat. He won't die if he doesn't eat. But he acts like he is hungry because to evoke that motherly love in Mother Yashoda and to taste her love. So his devotees are something like that. His exalted confidential devotees. They don't need to eat. They don't, their spiritual self is so strong that they have no need to eat, no need to cover themselves. And even the, it is mentioned, the Shukdev Goswami was walking and they were in the river. They were completely naked and they were bathing. And when they saw Shukdev Goswami walking by, they didn't even bother to cover their bodies. Because they saw that personality, they said, he doesn't even distinguish that man or woman. He doesn't even see us like that. So the point is, at that level, then it's not torture. In fact, Shukdev Goswami, for them, clothes are burden. He says in the second canto of Bhagavatam, are there not any torn clothes lying on the road? Are they not bark of trees? Don't you have your palms? Why do you need vessels? For them, it's a burden to actually carry these material things. And they have such a capacity that they can get anything material they want. Out of their mystic power, they can create. Kardama was living in the forest. Now please understand that Kardama was living in a very way. I'll, 2 minutes, is that okay? I tell the story of Kardama and we stop. And then we had one more question I'll take also. So he was living in the forest, very, very simple, very austere. And Devahuti married Kardama. She was born as a princess and she was married to Kardama. She became emaciated. Her hair was disheveled because she didn't take care of it. She couldn't get proper food. And she was completely emaciated. But she faithfully served her husband with cheerfulness, with no problems, with no complaints. And then the time came when Devahuti said that, you know, we should have children. And she said, but look at me. You know, I'm not even, my body is completely emaciated. My hair is completely disheveled. My clothes are really in rags. And how will you actually, you know, even have children in this I am. And then Kardama, by his mystic power, he said, go and enter, take bath in that particular lake. And Devahuti went and took the lake. And in that lake, there were thousands of servants waiting to, you know, decorate her body. And when she came out, Kardama had built from his mystic power a plane. You know, plane means a Cessna with that propeller. No, it was a 7-story castle. It could fly anywhere. There were lakes, swans, peacocks in that plane. And that plane could go to the planets, that plane could go to anywhere, wherever their mind desired, they would go. That's about it. So he built that powerful castle, and they both enjoyed life in that castle. So the point is, for those exalted personalities, matter is actually a burden. Less matter, no matter is even better, because they are purely spiritual. So in that sense, they are not torturing. But if you are in the modes of nature and you are torturing for sake of something material, that Krishna says is very condemnable. Make sense? All right. Srinivas Garu, last again, question and we'll stop.
Again, this question about the meat thingy.
Yes, sir.
Are there any exceptions, like if somebody eats a meat, or like no exceptions? The reason I ask is, I'm not sure this story in Ramayana about Vatapi. So Agastya Mahamuni eats...
I heard that story.
It's not authentic. I read it in one of the translation things. I'm not sure if it is authentic or not. If it is authentic, if it is not authentic, like we can ignore that.
But so please tell the question. Everybody who don't know the question can...
The story of Vatapi is like the two demons in the forest.
Mm-hmm.
They keep like Vatapi becomes a goat. And for the travelers, Vatapi elder brother, I forgot his name. So Ila. He cooks the goat. And the travelers, once they eat, like he calls Vatapi, come out. Then Vatapi cuts his, the tummy and comes out. And both demons eat this thing. Mm. So that's this thing. So once the Agastya Mahamuni going that way, they try to play the same trick. And they do the same thing, and Vatapi becomes goat, and they cooks. Agastya Mahamuni eats. In fact, this thing they use, Vatapi Jirnam, they eat for the kids. So Vatapi is eaten by Agastya Mahamuni. This Ila calls Vatapi, come. So where is Vatapi? Vatapi already digested, Agastya Mahamuni says. Vatapi is digested. So that's the story. So
did Agastya Mahamuni say, come see tomorrow morning and meet your brother? Okay. So again, the story, I'm not sure if it's authentic or not. But there is one verse in Srimad Bhagavatam, it's in the 11th canto. It is mentioned that the spiritually powerful persons, they're so powerful that they can eat contaminated stuff and it will not affect them. And they can withstand the effects. For some reason, it's mentioned by accident or some other reason, they eat, then they are not affected. Now we don't know if the story is A, authentic, B, we don't know the intentions of Agastya. Was he planning to clean the forest of these two demons who are torturing others, and therefore he accepted it? We don't know the intentions. So because he did and he survived, it's a lesson that probably it's not a good thing for commoners like us. But in the modern context, there is no reason to eat meat. You have plenty of food, you have milk, otherwise, but you still have something to survive. And there's no reason to do it. And it's such a shame that in the modern society that we have so many slaughterhouses and people eat meat for the sake of just eating it, for the satisfaction of their tongue. That is the problem. But if it's a desperate situation, you have nothing to eat, God forbid, never happens, and then you are about to die or something like that, I don't know, maybe. But otherwise, no. In a normal context, you'll be fine. Make sense? Everywhere you go to the world, there is some milk, There are some fruits, if some things to survive, it's not that bad. And we hope and pray that California famine, like, you know, it gets over soon. Other questions, comments, concerns? So we have two more classes. Anybody remembers the date? Right? After that you won't have to see my old rotten face, guaranteed, for at least for some time. So the 18th chapter, so the beauty is that Krishna's instructions to Arjuna are complete in 17 chapters. The whole of 18 chapters is actually a summary, entire summary of Bhagavad Gita. And it's a long chapter, so it's 78 verses. So that's the reason we had two classes. It's practically impossible to complete it in one class, and you wouldn't do justice either, unless we really go fast. You don't want either. All right. Any exam? I think it's January 17th. That's the. But some few devotees said that they have to travel, and you know, my apologies to them, but we'll make up to them, because I have one conclusion. Any date is not perfect for all the devotees. Any date. If it is January 10th, then somebody else will have an issue. If it's January 23rd, then it's just impossible. But having said that, those who are traveling or those who are outside of Bay Area, then, you know, please RSVP to Shyamalangi Mataji. And if you're outside the Bay Area, please RSVP also. Along with the RSVP, send the name of your proctor to whom you will be going to get your exam administered. Other questions, comments? Rati Krishna Prabhu, you had any instructions for us today? Rasa Krishna, thank you. All right, so who is here today? Oh, you are there. You have been hiding, Sundarananda Prabhu. Please forgive me. You've been, I was just waiting for you. I was like dreading that I wouldn't waste your time. Everybody's coming to you, and how can I deprive of that opportunity? Oh, Krishna, Krishna, Krishna. You are there, so sorry. Otherwise, I would have just... Anyway, I will not incur the wrath of people. Because I... Ekadashi, I didn't eat much to run. All right, thank you so much. We will meet in 2 weeks. Vancha kalpatarubhyascha kripasindhu.